Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the newsroom of the Chicago Tribune. It's Tuesday, and that means it must be your culture lunch. We got all kinds of fascinating topics. We got Jerry Lewis. We got levitating vehicles. We got public art. You don't want to go anywhere else. Joining me today, our panelists, Scott Powers, arts entertainment editor of the Chicago Tribune, and Nina Metz, intrepid arts and entertainment reporter. So our first item is this, you know, in the last day or so, one of those really cool big ideas sort of came out. The guy behind Tesla, the profitable electric cars, came up with this other idea of a sort of a, I think it's called the Hyperloop scheme. It's sort of a very elaborate sort of cross between sort of, you know, a monorail and science fiction that's going to theoretically transport people between Los Angeles and San Francisco in unbelievably brief amounts of time.
Like 90 minutes
like
or something
90
like
minutes. So yes. Comparable to a plane, but not actually taking, not actually going into the air. So you read about this, Scott. What do you think of this? Is this practical, doable, or is this just kind of science fiction nonsense?
Well, it almost doesn't matter if it's practical or doable at this point in time because it's in the future. But I mean, that's why films from Stanley Kubrick and George Lucas and Steven Spielberg have fascinated us for so many years, is that we love these kinds of fresh new ideas that take us literally, in this case, somewhere where we've never been before and really capture the imagination. And this certainly does that, I think, in terrific ways.
Well, I was gonna say, we really haven't had like the new mode of transportation since the airplane, really, right?
Right.
Or sort of rocket sort
of
travel.
That's sort of true, because it's like, you know, you travel now. I was thinking about this, how much technology has changed. You can sit in the U.S. and you can text people in Paris, but when it comes to getting from the U.S. to France, you're still on the same 7747, 777 that you were always on. The journey time has not changed
that's
on those
right.
long.
Not that much.
And even the bullet train that this would theoretically replace in California is a sort of a, I mean, what, 120 miles an hour? Big deal.
Does that,
you know, I mean, this is a lot more exciting, right?
What's interesting is he also says this is going to be a lot cheaper to build than the monorail that they were talking about, right?
Isn't
that?
Right.
So,
yes.
But it sounds like that, I don't know, the way I read the story, he sounds like this is the idea. I don't really have any intention of working on it at the moment.
Well, he says he's busy.
He's busy making all those millions and billions.
We're all busy. But, you know, it's great to have a big thinker emerge. Like, I mean, who are the really big thinkers at the moment? I mean, obviously, Steve Jobs is gone. Who has replaced him as kind of the great, you know, thinker, the guy who comes up with this
that's
kind
a,
of idea?
That's a great point, because we've just been talking about Jeff Bezos, obviously, who is a big thinker, but really in terms of business. And maybe right now there's such a focus on who's the big thinker in business, but there's also just this big thinker in terms of ideas and, you know, like an Edison-type person.
Right, in communities.
Right, in communities.
And technology, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
So
totally different.
Public art, let's talk about that for a sec. So there's a whole bunch of new sculptures that have shown up in Grant Park. You know, so there's this sort of great tradition of public art, particularly sculptures in Chicago. The Summit Millennium Park. I was walking through there the other day, and there were these signs saying "Respect the sculptures and don't have a good time." And many of us remember the famous cows of Chicago. Probably, for my money, the single most successful public art project, like in any American city. I mean, it wasn't original here, but it certainly was sort of made large here. I mean, what do we think of the state of public art? Does it feel like it's, you know, do we want to see more of it? What do we think about that, Scott?
Well, I think we want to see more of it. I mean, I was just in Minneapolis last week, and they have great public art there, and it's really refreshing to see something that you haven't seen before. And I think the next time there's some sort of public outrage about public art, then we're doing our jobs the right way, because you look at the big Picasso at Daley Plaza. People didn't like it when it first came out, and to me, public art needs to stimulate and get people to think in different ways. And
you know,
we haven't had that.
And I've had visitors to Chicago this summer, and one of the things they all want to see, the Bean, probably one of the most successful any cultural project in Chicago in the last 10 years. It is hard to top the Bean, or as one of my visitors said, I want to see the Egg. I said the Egg. but really hugely successful. I mean, do you see Nina Metz prancing around at the Bean, like looking at your reflection?
Look, every time people come in town, they want to. It's also because it's sort of interactive.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? Which I think is part of the appeal. You go in and take your picture.
Changes
upside
with
down.
The time and the weather.
Right. I mean, I think sort of what we're talking about, there's sort of two different types of public art. There's sort of the temporary, like the Marilyn Monroe statue that was outside of the Tribune for a long time, and they stay for several months and then they're gone. And then there's things like the Picasso, which become these iconic sort of landmarks to a city, which I think are, they become sort of ingrained, they start showing up in movies, and they really become part of the fabric of a city. The thing about Cows on Parade, it was fun, cheesy and tacky, but it was short-lived, which I thought was perfect. I think if those cows had stayed along Michigan Avenue and everywhere else, it would have sort of, you know, you start not to see it
anymore. And accessibility is important, right? Yes, so what's your perfect piece of public art? Like, if you were in charge of it, what would you like?
Well, I do think the Bean is almost perfect. I mean, because it stands by itself as a great piece of art, yet it's extremely interactive, unlike the fountains right just to the south of it, which probably don't stand up that well in terms of great art, but are
the
very
spitting
accessible.
Fountains,
are very accessible to people.
Yeah.
It's so aesthetically gorgeous, that Bean.
I was there just a day ago, and I was like, you know, and you're like, oh, let's go around the other side and see something entirely different. I mean, it's the coolest thing in Chicago. And I tell you, it is the number one thing people want to do.
Yep.
And it, you know, it's a big money spinner, that Bean. I tell you, big money spinner. Jerry Lewis. Okay, so what's a cultural show without Jerry Lewis? The guy that just keeps... he'll be giving, you know, 100 years after his death, that guy will still be giving. New movie surfaced, or at least a part of a lost movie. So let's take a look at this image. Some people are saying this is part of the worst movie ever made.
Lewis.
The day the clown cried.
Should we talk about what it is?
Set it up for us, Nina.
It's based on a script by I think a PR agent and a TV writer who sort of
those two things always go well together.
Two unlikely interests. One was one of the writers was really just delving into a lot of research about the Holocaust and was also at the same time representing clowns. And somehow these two ideas came together. So the premise of the film, of the original script, is that there is a clown who's not Jewish but sort of speaks out against Hitler in Germany, is sort of taken into custody, put in a concentration camp, and then he sort of uses his clownly wiles on the children of the concentration camp, and he's sort of forced to lead them into a gas chamber where they die. I mean, it's the sort of... It's hard to imagine how this was supposed to work in any sense.
So why is this emerge now? What do you think of this?
I think when he was in Cannes Film Festival the last time, there was some reference to it, and he said, "No, that's always going to go away." I think artists should be able to fail in private. All right, at least while they're alive. And obviously, even Lewis admits that this was a horrible failure and never to be seen, at least in terms of his wishes. It surfaced fine, but I think it should be held in context that, you know, artists need to experiment and take chances, few of which are going to succeed. I mean, that's the great thing about art. Most of it isn't very good.
But it's hard to believe anybody thought this was a good idea.
Right.
Well, so it's sort of complicated why no one has seen it. Part of it is that maybe Jerry Lewis recognized at some point this thing is a colossal failure.
Although he's not known for his self-awareness, right? I mean,
But also, there was a lot of financial problems, and also sort of the producers totally messed up the whole, they optioned the rights to the script, but then sort of didn't complete the sort of payment structure, so they actually then lost the rights to the script. So they can't legally release this movie, even if Jerry Lewis decided he wanted to.
Right.
The rights holders don't want to sort of.
So we'll never see.
This is what I want to read to you. So Harry Shearer, who's a comedic actor, he's a radio personality, is one of the few people to have actually seen the film somehow. He knew someone who worked on the Jerry Lewis marathon or telethon, so he sort of somehow got access to a movie, and I thought his quote about it was kind of fascinating. He said it's like if you flew down to Tijuana and suddenly saw a painting on black velvet of Auschwitz. You just think, my God, wait a minute. It's not funny, it's not good, and somebody's trying too hard in the wrong direction to convey this strongly held feeling.
Yeah. Well, there you go. Well, the other bit of culture news this week. So it turned out that William Shakespeare, all the time, actually wrote part of Thomas Kyd's play, The Spanish Tragedy. Now, for those of you not Elizabethan geek, let me explain. So the Spanish Tragedy has always been assumed by scholars to have been an earlier play than the plays of Shakespeare himself, and a sort of a precursor. There's bits of the Spanish Tragedy that sort of resemble Hamlet. It's always been assumed that Kyd did a lot that Shakespeare really went on and copied, but there's been sort of revelations this last few days that Shakespeare wrote at least some of the passages, a particular section of the Spanish Tragedy. And what this really reveals, I think, Scott, is that, you know, we think now about writers' rooms, right? So much of our art now is created collectively in these writers' rooms. All the big hit TV shows have writers' rooms. The Elizabethan playwrights were doing the same darn thing. They just had different notions of ownership. They were constantly, you know, borrowing and picking from each other's work.
Punching up each other's scripts.
Right. Right. There's a table and they're sitting around it.
Well, not quite.
But the interesting, I'm not the Shakespeare scholar that you are, but it was interesting to me that some of the handwriting was so illegible that that was made the scholarship very difficult. I found that to be really interesting,
having
bad
dubious.
Handwriting.
No one can sort of say definitively that
William
Shakespeare wrote all the plays.
Who wrote what in that era?
Right.
And yet we're so obsessed with it, right?
Right.
It's kind of bizarre to me.
We don't know who writes what in this era either.
That's true.
For different reasons.
So, lastly today, the great duo Stephen Eydie Gorme died this week. Her great solo hit, "Blame It on the Bossa Nova," but also sort of decades of old school Vegas class. That may sound oxymoronic, I know, but they really were the duo were kind of their shtick was all about and being an old married couple and not getting along that well, but loving each other really. And they sort of, you know, they were fascinating because they avoided rock and roll. Rock and roll came, they said, we don't want to pretend to do that, we're just going to carry on with the standards. And, you know, Steve is still going, but Eydie, alas, no longer. There's not many of these guys left, Scott, right?
Very few.
Very, the
very
old school Vegas style. Right. This Frank's gone. I mean, there's just not many of them left.
We just appreciate the craftsmanship behind all of that. I mean, I remember way back when I was growing up, my mother was a big Steve and Eydie fan, especially Eydie, and listening to those records over and over and over again. And you really understand the craftsmanship behind the harmonies. I mean, it was really a fascinating way that they did that. And you look at things today, like behind the Caballero with the Liberace story on
yes.
HBO. You understand some of the craftsmanship and the hard work that goes behind making something that seems as effortless as
and
that.
As accessible. And are you a Blame It on the Bossa Nova fan then, Nina Mess?
No.
There are
guys who are sort of trying to walk that same path, like Josh Groban,
Josh
and Michael Bublé.
Right.
So, I mean, there are younger.
The form
singers.
Lives on, right?
To some, I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
Those two are show-offs, though, to a certain extent. Steve and Eydie were smooth as silk, and it seemed effortless, but it was really good.
Well, we'll miss Eydie, and interestingly enough, you know, when the Chicago Theater opened in the mid '80s, you know, who was very involved in that in the public campaign for its restoration, Eydie Gorme. So.
Why?
We'll
does she have a connection to Chicago?
No, she was just, they loved historic venues. They were old school. They understood that a city needs to have a glamorous night out for regular folks, and that's what they did. You could go there, you could see a sort of idealized or even realistic version of your own marriage, and you could hum Blame It on the Bossa Nova. Hum away, have a great afternoon, see you next time.